This is Jack Rice at the United Nations with Pamela Falk, foreign affairs analyst for a whole series of people. Pam, thanks so much for coming on.
Sure. It's a pleasure to be here. It's really a great building with a lot of history.
I talk to you so often about things going on in the world, and you talk about what's happening right here. In some ways, this is the world in a microcosm. It's really different, isn't it?
It is. This is the, as you mentioned, 192 countries, so every country has a vote. It's often why you see difficult decisions being made. It's also what's called soft law. In other words, sort of the real power at the United Nations is at the Security Council. This is the more democratic piece of the United Nations, where there's peacekeeping and where there are some of the biggest refugee issues that are this organization and this part of the organization is charged with dealing with all of the world crises, with Darfur. But the real serious use of force issues go over to the smaller 15-member Security Council. But this is where the Pope came. This is where the United Nations, every member of the United Nations, all the countries stood up to celebrate the Pope's birthday. This is where there's fights and where countries, just to make a diplomatic statement, walk out on other countries. It's really the complexity of diplomacy, and it's really an interesting place. The best piece of this piece of the organization, of this part, is that every nation can be in the same place at the same time. And that in and of itself is in many ways the best part of the United Nations.
You mentioned the Security Council, all 15 votes. Again, the P5, these are the permanent five everybody knows about. But the 192 nations here, most of them, they rarely have a voice on the world stage. This seems to give them that opportunity. And how important do you think that is?
I think it's very important because, first of all, for their own audiences, they show that they're speaking to the world. They also can have a voice where other countries, especially the major powers, might not otherwise meet with them. But in the halls of the United Nations, in the diplomats' lounge, they get a voice and they get to say, this is something that's very important to us, even if we're a really small country. And when you have the 192 countries here, many are very small.
You're here regularly. You're here all the time. I think there's a perception of what the United Nations represents to some people in this country. Sometimes it's positive, sometimes it's negative. Are they both right? Are they both wrong? I mean, what is it that the American people don't particularly understand in general about this place?
Well, first and foremost, U.S. citizens are ruled by U.S. law. And so to have a world body is a difficult concept. And the idea that there's an international organization that would rule everyone is not something the United Nations was ever intended to be. And that's sometimes a misperception in the American public. In other words, it's where every nation can get together and would hope to end any kind of conflicts and find peace. It's not an authority or world body intended to be a world organization or world nation. And so that, I think, sometimes is something that, especially in the United States, there's a feeling that why should the United Nations tell us something? Now, on the other hand, in a global economy, in a global world, you have to have consensus on a lot of issues or at least deal with your allies and sometimes adversaries. And that you can do here. That's the best part of the United Nations. The U.S. walked away from UN support during the Iraq War, and many people feel that there is going to be a return to multilateralism. It's by the Republicans and the Democratic candidates are all talking about it because there's a need to get other nations on board. That's probably the best. Finally, there is a piece of corruption that we saw in the last 10 years and principally in the last 3 years of the United Nations with the oil for food crisis. It's a big bureaucracy and there are bad apples in it. And so that really is, it's important to weed those out. And that really was a stain on the U.S. UN history. And so I think we're now seeing there's a new Secretary General, Ban Ki-moon. He is traveling the world nonstop. And I think that's really helping the credibility of the organization.
You mentioned multilateralism and the need by both left and right to come back to it. How willing do you think the world will be to embrace the U.S. again with open arms, left or right?
Well, the U.S. is the only superpower now. When you were talking about the Cold War, that was a bipolar world. The U.S. is the only superpower, and I think it will be accepted if it comes back into this organization, and it the curious thing is, even as a superpower, the United States needs other countries for Iraq reconstruction, for Iran support to stop other countries from getting nuclear weapons. All of that is very important, the Middle East peace negotiations. And so I think if the United States comes back into it, and you've heard Senator McCain on the Republican side, the Democrats on the candidates on the Democratic side, Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton, all talking about the fact that there should be support with Russia, with other countries, to try to rein in nuclear weapons by rogue states. So that's something that I think is a scary new era in this war on terror, that the United States recognizes it really does need the United Nations.
Thank you, Pam.
Sure, Jack. It's a pleasure to be here.
I guess we have to say that if we're going to talk about multilateralism, maybe this is the most appropriate place to do it, the floor of the General Assembly. This is Jack Rice at the United Nations.